هو الله أحد الله الصمد لم يلد ولم يولد ولم يكن له كفوا أحد.
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد.
First, I'd like to thank Taha Collective for inviting me here. This is perhaps the biggest honor of my life to sit on the minbar of Imam Hussein in front of you all today. It's also appropriate that my first time reciting a majlis is actually in a church. You all know the reverence with which our faith holds Isa ibn Maryam, the great prophet Jesus. The Spirit of God, Isa ibn Allah, as referred to in the Maritha. For me personally, there's a stronger connection to Hazrat Isa as well. About 17 years ago, I was studying in graduate school in Miami, Florida, which was a very lonely place for me, very far away from family. It was the first time I was actually living away from home. College I went to very close to home. I commuted for half the time. And one night, I had a dream. And I was sitting in my house, which I grew up in, looking out the back sliding door. And there was a thunderstorm outside. And suddenly there was lightning. And in the window was standing Hazrat Isa. And I suddenly woke. I don't know what that means, but in terms of actually seeing somebody of that caliber in a dream, alhamdulillah, I took it as a blessing. I've asked a lot of scholars about it. Nobody's really given me a good answer, except maybe one, Sheikh Jihad Ismail from Australia, as it happens, explained to me that Hazrat Isa was somebody who went through a lot of challenges in his life, and he overcame them by sticking to justice, and this was the message that was being conveyed. So, salawat.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
I'd like to talk to you a little bit today about the concept of Tawheed in Islam. Now, as it was mentioned, I'm an activist, I'm not a scholar. Any mistakes that I made are my own. God forgive me for those mistakes. If there's anything that you hear that you know is incorrect, please speak up. I'm totally open to this being a discussion. So, very simply, Tawheed is the Islamic belief in the oneness or unity of God. It's the first article of our faith, Usuluddin. Everything else stems from it, the others being other than the Nubuwwat, Imamat, and Qiyamah, as you all know. It forms the first part of the testimony of faith, the Shahada, La ilaha illallah, Muhammad Rasulullah. There is no God but Allah. Muhammad is his prophet. The interesting thing to me when analyzing the first half of this is the way that it's phrased. There is no God but Allah. If you were thinking about conveying the idea of one God, there's a lot of ways you could phrase that. You could say, Allah is the only God. You could say, Allah is the one God. But why is it phrased in this way? There is no God. It's interesting because maybe there, of course, this is a divine phrase, so we have to think about it in the logical reasoning of why, in terms of our own human wisdom, why it was done this way. Maybe the thought, the divine thought, or the divine thinking is that it has to be an absolute state, because you don't know who's going to come centuries later and say, oh, but what about this God? Muslims didn't realize this 1500 years ago, but you know, there's another God, he's more powerful. So the statement itself, its syntax, is in such a way that it's an absolute statement, that no other God but Allah. Tawheed is also the most important tenet of Islamic belief, and it's reiterated during our daily salat in Surah Ikhlas, also known as Surah Tawheed, which I recited in the beginning. The translation of that surah. In the name of Allah, the beneficent, the merciful, say, He, Allah, is one. Allah is He on whom all depend. He begets not, nor is He begotten, and none is like Him. It's a short surah, we recite it every day, but the weight of the surah can be determined by the multiple hadiths that narrates that the Prophet said that this surah alone is equivalent to one-third of the Quran. The Shia commonly understand Tawheed as being categorized into three equally important parts that make up the whole concept of the oneness of God. This is according to Muslim theologians. So the three parts of Tawheed. The first is the oneness of God's existence, meaning that there is no God but Allah. Again, the part that is la ilaha illallah. And this is also, again, in Surah Ikhlas, in Qul huwa Allahu Ahad, say he, Allah is one. And Allah is Samad, Allah is he, on whom all depend. The second part of Tawheed is the oneness of God's essence, meaning that he is indivisible and not compound. He's not made up of parts. This can be seen in the third verse. Lam yalid wa lam yulad. He begets not, nor is he begotten. If he was a child of somebody or he had children, that would mean that there are some parts to him. The third aspect of Tawheed is the uniqueness of God's attributes, meaning that there is nothing like him. This is in the last part of the surah. So I'm going to basically go into these three a little bit deeper. First, the oneness of God's existence, the first part. So theologians argue that existence is either necessary or contingent. Either your existence is a necessity, or it's based on or contingent upon another necessity. So by necessary, what Muslim theologians mean is that something that is existent in its essence, which does not need anything else in order to exist. The contingent, on the other hand, needs that necessary existence for its own existence. So theologians agree that God is the only necessary existent. All other things have ever or will ever exist in this world are contingent upon that necessary existent. To substantiate this point, they point to the limitedness and changing nature of everything else in this world. Whereas the necessary existence is constant and without limit. Further, philosophers, theologians agree that it's a logical impossibility for there to be more than one necessary existence from which all contingent beings derive their existence, and that one necessary existence is God. Now, the second part, the oneness of God's essence, a few more details on that. This is a term that's used to describe the indivisible nature of God's essence, just to say that his essence is not compound, not made up of parts. Theologians use the following arguments to assert this indivisible nature of God's essence. Anything that's compound, that's made up of parts, is in need of those parts or elements to form up its composition. And a necessary existence transcends that need, and therefore God cannot be compound. And if the essence of God was compound, that would necessitate the existence of another higher causer or creator that would make those parts. So a car is made up of an engine, seats, a steering wheel, wheels, but somebody else makes those parts, correct? So a car just doesn't exist on its own. So this assumption is contrary to the original assumption that God is the necessary existence. Now the third part, the uniqueness of God's attributes. Those are broken up into two parts. You have affirmed attributes, al-sifat al-tubutiya, and negated attributes, al-sifat al-salbiya. The negated attributes are those that have to be negated from God's essence, because they're contrary to a necessary existence. The most important of these attributes that need to be negated in regards to God's essence is his form, the fact that he has any shape. And the affirmed attributes, or the positive attributes of Allah, are those that are not contrary to him being a necessary existence. And theologians have divided those into two categories, attributes of the essence and attributes of action. Attributes of the essence include things like power and knowledge, omniscience and omnipotence. And the opposites, such as ignorance and inability, are separated from God. Now, the attributes of action don't necessarily have to be part of God. Those include things like he is the creator, he's the giver of life. Well, some theologians say he's only becomes the creator once he's created. He's only the giver of life once he's given life. Before that, he wasn't those things. But the other half of scholars say, no, he was the creator and the giver of life, even if he didn't do that, because he had that ability. So there's a very interesting sermon by Mamali Nedubalapa, which I'm sure Sadiq is nodding, and I'm sure he's read it, and some of you have as well, on Tawheed, Sermon 185. It's a very long sermon. I encourage you all to go home and read it, but there's one paragraph that I think really sticks out. And the thing that is really interesting to me about it is that the way Imam Ali explains Tawheed, the oneness of God, to us human beings. So he understands his audience. If you listen to this paragraph, you'll see that the way he explains it, it may not be necessarily the way he understands it for himself, but he's speaking to people in a very simple way. And he understands that humans are self-centered, that they compare everything to themselves. So what he does is he negates all those things that we use to compare ourselves to other humans and says, God is not like that. God is not like your neighbor or your friend. When you meet somebody new, God is not comparable to another human being. Listen to this paragraph. It cannot be said that he has a limit or extremity or end or termination. Nor do things control him so as to raise him or lower him. Nor does anything carry him so as to bend him or keep him erect. He is not inside things nor outside them. He conveys news, but not with a tongue or voice. He listens, but not with holes of the ears or the organs of hearing. He says, but does not utter words. He remembers, but does not memorize. He determines, but not by exercising his mind. He loves and approves without any sentimentality of heart. He hates and feels angry without any pain state. When he intends to create someone, he says, be, and there he is, but not through a voice that strikes the ears or a call that can be heard. His speech is an act of his creation. His light never existed before this. If it had been eternal, it would have been in the second God. So think about that. I mean, he actually uses, the first half of the sentences are things that we can relate to. He talks about loving and feeling angry and saying, being inside things or outside things. And then the second half of the sentences are, but not like you. So he wants us to be able to relate to our God, but realize that this entity, this universal supreme being, is not like us. It can be analyzed, I think, for a long time, but this is what I got at it. And I'm sure you all will have other ways of looking at it as well. So. I want to make this a little bit more personal as well, because our personal relationships with God are unique. And at the end of the day, we have our own reasons for our belief. And since the purpose of my talk is to discuss how to present the concept of Tawheed to others, whether through words or actions, I'd like to share my own reasons for believing in God. I had never really written these down before until a friend of mine asked me a few years ago why I believed in God. And I think this is a good exercise, just because it clarifies things, it makes you question it, and do perhaps more research. So my first reason, there's five that I listed. My first reason is that in a cause and effect world, there must be a first cause or first mover. That is, the Big Bang, for example, is the first effect, and God being the first cause of the effect. This relates to the cosmological argument that I discussed earlier. The second one is that as a student of science myself, the remarkable structure and organization of the natural world and cosmos points me to believe in a supremely intelligent creator. This is referred to as a teleological argument. And I'd like to give you an example of this, personal example of something that I learned in my graduate embryology class years and years ago when I was in the Corps. But I'll tell you about it. And some of you may know this, some of you may have science background. But it really fascinated me and opened me up to sort of the wonders of the natural world that are inside us. The universe that is inside us is an anomaly. So you all know that the fertilized egg is two sets of 23 chromosomes coming to form the first cell. And that cell starts to replicate and multiply, becomes 2, and then 4, and then 8, 16. So eventually, initially those cells are all the same. You have maybe hundreds of cells that are all the same, but there's a process called differentiation that takes place. And that's the first time that the cells start looking different from each other. And in the first differentiation, the cells take on one of three characters. They either become something called the endoderm, the ectoderm, or the mesoderm. And each three of these types of cells will become the entire human body. The endoderm will eventually become all your organs, your intestines, your heart, your liver, your pancreas, every organ that you have. The ectoderm will become your brain, your spinal cord, your skin, and your eyes. The mesoderm will become your muscles and your bones. The part that really got me was when we got to the point how the heart forms in the human body. So those three different types of cells differentiate further. So that, you know, the endoderm starts becoming cells in the different organs, and then some of them start becoming heart cells. Now, if I was an all-powerful, intelligent being, and I was constructing the heart, the way I would do it is I'd fashion the heart, and, you know, maybe I would, like clay, I don't know, like pottery, like, and I would make the outside, it would be solid, and then maybe I would put the, you know, dig into it and put holes in it, and then I would, you know, shock it with electricity, and then it would start pumping. I don't know. How does God do? So the first heart cells, when they differentiate, they're twitching. They're already twitching. And then they start replicating. So you have one that's twitching, and then two, and then four, and then eight. And they're all twitching. But they're all twitching in their own rhythms. You know, they're not, you know, they're sort of doing their own thing. And so now you have hundreds of these little cells, and they're twitching. And then suddenly, there's a critical mass of these heart cells. And they start coming close to each other. And they start touching. And slowly, they start synchronizing their twitch. And so they keep replicating. And they keep beating. And your heart, what's beating inside your body, the way it forms, is beating. It forms while it's beating. And when I learned that, I looked around and I thought, why isn't anybody else ready to fall off their chair? Because to me, the thousands of examples like these, the beauty of creation is evidence of David itself. God is beautiful and loves beauty, and that's why we formed this way. It didn't have to be this way, right? I mean, it could have formed very, very differently. The first sentence in that book of embryology was, the human body is a remarkable system with its own backbone. And the word that really stuck out to me in that book was, well, you know, science is so rational. Why did this professor who wrote this book that all these graduate schools and medical schools use, why did he use the word remarkable? Why did he use an adjective? Because he couldn't help himself, right? If he was rational and objective, he would say, well, this is the human body, and this is how it's made. It's a remarkable system. He has to recognize it. So, so that was my second reason in a very long-winded way. The third reason, this is sort of the logical proof. And some people have attributed it to Hazrat Ali, but I think it's either a weak hadith or it comes from somewhere else, so I'm not going to say that it's definitely from him. So there's four scenarios. They're based on a belief in or not belief in God, and whether there is or is not actually God. So the four scenarios are, if you believe in God, and there is a God, well, that's a good thing, because you will end up in a good place. The second scenario is, if you believe in God and there is no God, well, you live a good and moral life and not lose much, except perhaps some things in this world. The third scenario is, if you don't believe in God, and there is no God, you lose nothing. But if you don't believe in God, and there is a God, well, that doesn't add up to anything very good at all. So it's better logically to believe in God, even if there actually isn't a God. That's the third reason that I have personally to believe in God. Fourth is very personal as well. Many of you have probably heard of the concept of istihara. So istihara is a method used by faithful Muslims who sometimes are in a position of doubt about something in their lives, often about major decisions, whether it could be marriage, it could be buying a house, it could be doing a surgery. And so they will use rosary beads or the Quran, they'll ask an Alim or somebody who's known to be just and pious to take out an istihara through the Quran, for example, and say a verse, say bismillah, say salawat, and open the Quran to a verse, and the verse will give them some sort of guidance. So there are times in my life where I have done an istihara, and it's never pointed me in a bad direction. And that is a very strong indication for me. My fifth and most important reason for believing in God is the feeling of God's presence around me all the time. Pulling me in towards the right path continuously, leaving me content without needing any external power or support. I think this is what people call wealthy. It's not something that you do yourself. Allah gives something. And I think perhaps it can relate back to the day of creation. And there's two very beautiful lines of poetry by Ali Muhammad Rizvi, who's a famous Urdu Nahaha, which illustrates this. He says, Roze Allah se poocha gaya, kya pasand? Roze Allah se poocha gaya, kya pasand? Be-akhtiyar humne pukara, ghamayas. So on the day of creation, we were asked, what do you love? Our belief is that all the souls that will ever exist in the universe were all created on the day of creation, and Allah asked, what do you love? And we cried out, or I cried out, uncontrollably, the sorrows. So on that day is when we decide, what is it that we love? Is it God that we love? Is it the material world that we love? And perhaps the souls in this room made that choice on that day. So, forcefully look to remove all signs of religion from public life, for example, that's one of their goals. But if you read Dawkins' most famous book, The God Delusion, you might notice a strangely emotional tone to it, rather than a scientific or rational approach to religion. And this is a basic criticism, that the movement is aggressive rather than rational. And if atheists want to save us from the burdens of religion, if they're being sincere, you'd think they'd be nicer about it. You know, is it really for you, or is it for some other reason? And that's another lesson to learn. Sometimes we meet people in our own communities who are trying to convince us so strongly to be a certain way that you think, is it really for me, or is it for them, or ego? And that's why akhlaq in our faith is so important, how you approach people in conveying anything, in communicating. Another interesting thing about this fairly new phenomenon, new atheism, is that it's taken on a racial and gender-biased following, mostly white males. And along with an overtly Islamophobic message that uses clash of civilizations framing for Middle East conflicts, it's no surprise that this has become just another tool for white supremacy and power, if you start getting into it. But the best commentary I've read was from a professor named Jonathan Sacks, who some of you may have heard of. He's a professor of law, ethics, and the Bible at the prestigious King's College in London, and formerly chief rabbi of the United Kingdom. And he feels that new atheists miss the target by believing that the cure for bad religion is no religion, as opposed to good religion. He writes, "Atheism deserves better than the new atheist, whose methodology consists of criticizing religion without understanding it, quoting texts without contexts, taking exceptions as the rule, confusing folk belief with reflective theology, abusing, mocking, ridiculing, caricaturing, and demonizing religious faith and holding it responsible for the great crimes against humanity. Religion has done harm. I acknowledge that. But the cure for bad religion is good religion, not no religion. Just as the cure for bad science is good science, not the abandonment of science." He's the author of a book called Great Partnership, Science, Religion, and the Search for Meaning. You should want to check it out. So really getting back to the crux of the reason I'm talking about this is that whether you know people like this or you've met them online, there are very loud ex-Muslims talking about why Islam is bad religion, and you know, why it's, religion in general is horrible and why they should leave it. And we really need to start understanding why that is. Why is this happening? How is it possible that this religion that offers so much peace to so many souls has been a source for so much ire on a personal level for others? And I really attest to you that this is a failing on the part of our community and other religious communities. As Professor Sack says, what we need to do is replace bad religion with good religion. And I take that as a reflection of our approach to religion and communicating it to others in general. When I worked in a research lab at Columbia University, a coworker said to me, it's a really interesting statement, "I wish I believed in God. I wish I believed in God." So what does that mean? What that means is that this person is a sincere atheist. So we have to separate the sincere atheist from the provocateurs, right? In our faith, we believe that, again, Allah is still here. You can't force yourself to believe in God. But he also says, or theologians have said, that if you want to believe in God, show a desire to believe in God, and then Allah will, inshallah, give you. So this person who thinks he's an atheist is saying, "I wish I believed in God." In fact, he's not really an atheist. He's taking a step towards abilities and channels within. And I think one of the most interesting analogies, very simple analogy, that a friend of mine that I went to college with, who was a very faithful person, explained to me that really changed my approach to talking about faith in general, or actually not talking about it, talking about it less. And I think that's one of our failings in the community, that we like to talk about it. Even if we are faithful people, well, that's great. But sometimes, because we are human, we like to show that off. Hey, I'm so faithful or good or moral, or, you know, get up for pleasure every day. So should you. Maybe we don't say it every time, but we kind of hint it, like, hey, you know. So the way my friend explained this concept to me was that, you know, there could be a person who, like yourself, like myself, for example, I feel I'm a very privileged person in a lot of ways. I, you know, grew up in a very loving home, a spiritual home, a religious home. I got a good education, I had parents, have parents who are very educated in terms of spirituality and religion. And I was given a lot. So say if there's like a rudimentary scale of 1 to 10 in terms of what you've been given in terms of privilege. I would say, at least a 7. And say through all my hard work and everything that I do in my own life, through my own volition, through my own effort, then maybe on a less scale of justice, I go up to a 9. But say that there's somebody who's born to a cocaine addict mother without a husband, in a very poor home, with little access to education and healthcare, religion in a very poor part of the world. So we'd say maybe that person was born with privilege of maybe level 2. And say that that person, through their own life, through their own effort and their inspiration, that perhaps they work themselves up to level 6. Maybe. So perhaps in Allah's eyes, this person has moved up 4 levels out of their own effort. What does that mean? I moved up 2 levels. So in Allah's eyes, who would be more deserving of more reward? Now say if I was at a point in my life where I'm at an 8 and I meet this person and he's at 5. So the tendency for us is to judge people based on how we are. Remember Imam Ali's book? Because we are self-centered, and we look at other people and other things in comparison to us. So when you think about this, imagine every single person out there that you may be judging, even not deliberately, but it's just natural now when you interact with people. The person who's making your coffee, I don't know, anyone. You have no idea where that person started in their life, and where they are. And that person could be much higher, a much higher spiritual plane than you, just because of where, what God gave them and what they did for that. So, so I think in terms of where our community needs to go with this, is that we need to realize that some of these remnants, these cultural remnants that we have in terms of religion, that may have worked to really kind of deliver and keep our faith alive in other cultural contexts, don't necessarily fit here. What I've noticed in terms of long-term relationships in our society here, whether it's the workplace, you're working with people for years, with people at school, your neighbors, is that people like to very quickly kind of tell you when they start getting close to you how they feel about things. I started working at a new job last year, and the first interaction that we had that was social, that was outside of work, suddenly became about religion. And I didn't bring it up. Just because perhaps they knew I was Muslim, and I don't wear it on my sleeve, but I need to place some bread. So they know that. I don't drink. When they bought the boss a bottle of alcohol for Christmas, I said, well, I can't pay for that, but I'll get another gift. So, I mean, certain things where just normal daily activities sort of bring up the fact that, okay, this person is serious about their faith, somewhat, or maybe perhaps in comparison to others. So we talked about religion, and it was all negative, and they had absolutely no qualms about saying what was on their minds in a very nice and smiley way. But what I was looking at was their spirit of honesty. I loved it. I said, that's great. And I did not do that. Because I value their free speech, and that's wonderful. Because when you live a life, I think, personally, this is what I think, when you live a life of faith, step by step every day, that is a lot more powerful than anything you can say ever in any conversation. So if you are not a person who, you know, shoves religion into people's face, but rather to just live your own life that way, I think, especially in this society where people are so anti-religion, right, on the surface of it, they still respect a person who is sincerely faithful and isn't trying to sell their religion to others to feel better about themselves. And people recognize that. There's subtleties, especially in the long term. People get to know who you really are. They really do. There's not a lot of people who can keep up a charade for years and years from here. So I think that that is something that, and I think that's happening more and more, I think. But there is still a lot of skepticism, I think, in our society about religion. And I think that's why it's so important for us to not be scared to assert our own individual identity. Sometimes what happens is, because of that very strong, vociferous sort of onslaught verbally, people shy away from actually asserting their own right. That people will not ask for a place to pray anymore. Oh, no, no, I don't want to do that. I don't want people to know that I'm religious, they hate religion. Well, I mean, there is also a legal right besides your own religious duty. And you shouldn't be timid about just asserting your own individual needs and rights, inshallah. So, and undoubtedly, as that part of the world becomes more and more aware, industrialized and developed, this generation and generations to come will ask a lot of questions about evolutionary theory. And although the books above explain certain holes in evolutionary theory, most of them are in agreement with what evolutionists themselves can see are unresolved parts of the theory. Right? So evolution isn't a perfect theory, there's a hole in it. But there's overwhelming evidence, scientific evidence, for evolution. There's extensive citations in his books from scientists like Richard Dawkins, Stephen Jay Gould, Miles Aldrich, Francis Crick, and more very famous scientists. And some of the comments are used to support creationist theories, and others are used to refute evolutionary theory. And he's even separated his titles into beginner, intermediate, advanced. So as people get to know more, they can read sort of like more advanced books. So where his books largely fail are that they're all written with the initial premise that creation, as literally defined by scripture, must be true. And unfortunately, this premise doesn't allow them to make any truly scientific inquiries into the theory of evolution. For example, the way that Muslim scientists have done for centuries into other theories. They propose from the outset that the way the theory stands is antagonistic to creationism, Islam, and all religions. And this mindset just discounts all their conclusions. So one example I'd like to give in terms of what Yahya mentions is that according to Le Chatelier's principle, it's not possible for a reaction that releases water to take place in the Higgs environment. I'm going to make this really easy. So some of you may remember this from chemistry, depends on when you took chemistry, whether it was grad school or college or high school before that. But so reactants to products. So you have A plus B with an arrow going to C plus D. So if you add A or B, the reaction goes this way, right? But there's another arrow that goes this way. So if you add here, eventually you'll get C and D, but if you don't remove C and D while they're being made, it just goes backwards. So the theory of the origin of life that's accepted by most scientists is that life started from water. You probably heard this, right? Life started from water. Well, what does that mean? So the simplest biological molecule is RNA, which is the precursor to DNA. It's a simpler form of DNA. So RNA is made up of three things: a ribose sugar, a nucleotide, and a phosphate group. So there's three parts. So the idea is well, say if those three parts randomly, sometime in the existence of the universe, a long time ago, somehow came together in water, and then something catalyzed that reaction. Because you need a catalyst. You need like a spark to make a reaction happen. So the thought is that, oh, somehow these three things ended up in water somewhere, and then lightning struck, and boom, RNA was formed. Because those three things were water. So to prove this, what scientists do is they put these three things in water in the lab, they did it with electricity, and voila, those three things came together. But what Harun Yahya points out, which is actually accurate, is that they have a spigot, is that this water, as the electricity is striking the water and the RNA is being formed, the RNA is coming out as it's being formed, so the reaction keeps going. But in a lake, or a river, or a pond, there's no spigot. So the reaction just goes backwards. So he's saying if it was in a lake, and you form RNA, it would just separate again. You have to take the RNA out. It's an interesting thought, right? So either Harun Yahya is not up on the latest research, but as I was doing my research, I came upon a really interesting paper. Actually, it was referenced in a book. The comprehensive text on evolution back when I was in grad school was called Evolutionary Analysis, written in 2004 by Freeman and Scott. And in it, they say, James Ferris, a professor at RPI in Albany. Ferris, his ancestor was the inventor of the Ferris wheel. Same Ferris. Professor Ferris prepared a simple prebiotic soup in the lab and added the common clay mineral, not Moreland. This is a very special clay. Montmorillonite is a naturally occurring aluminum silicate clay to which organic molecules readily adhere. So these sort of molecules like RNA, they just stick to it. And when activated nucleotides stick to the montmorillonite, the clay acts as a catalyst and it joins them together in a polynucleotide chain. So it's like a catalyst. While bound to the clay, the polynucleotides form more rapidly in long chains of 8 to 10, even up to 50 nucleotides. Now this story of study of montmorillonite clay, another study was done down the street at Mass General in 2003. And it revealed that this clay can also increase the formation of membranous fluid-filled sacs. These vesicles grow and undergo a simple form of division, giving them properties of primitive cells. Commenting on this, another Origin of Life expert at the Salk Institute, Leslie Orgel, said, interestingly, the clay also gets internalized in the vesicles. So this work is quite nice in that it finds a connection between the mechanism that creates RNA and encloses it. It's interesting to note that the minerals present in montmorillonite clay enhance the production of enzymes in living organisms, and there are only 5 deposits of this clay on the entire Earth. The people who live in these areas, the very high mountainous regions, usually end up being 120 to 140 years old. And the reason for their longevity, apparently, is because the crops that are fertilized in those areas are grown with montmorillonite clay in the soil. These areas are the Wasatch Mountains in Utah, Himalayas in China and Tibet, Urals in Pakistan, the Caucasians in Georgia, and the Andes in Peru and Ecuador. Users of montmorillonite will report that their energy got better, their stamina got better, they had fewer colds, smoother skin complexion, better weight control, reduced arthritis pain, stronger and faster growing nails, their white hair became black again. So the interesting thing about this to me was, well, you know, growing up, we always learned that humans are made of clay. Now, I was just talking about the fact that, well, we shouldn't take things that are written wrong literally. But turns out, in this case, this is really fascinating. So what I did was, I did a search in the Quran for all the mentions of the word clay. And there's 8 instances. The word is theme. One verse, chapter 23, verse 12. And certainly we created man from an extract of clay. This really stuck out. I always felt like it was a metaphor, like I said, a figure of clay. But this correlation between the Quran and modern research into the origin of life could suggest otherwise. And perhaps the interpretation should be more literal. It doesn't necessarily prove anything, but it's just interesting. And because of the preponderance of evidence now suggests that montmorillonite was a catalytic substance that could have made the synthesis of RNA possible rather than water. Again, so this isn't supposed to be sanctimonious and try to convince you, you know, that this is definitely true or convince anyone that, you know, the Quran is correct and we should all follow Islam. But the point is that we need to move from examining scripture to explain the natural world to examining the natural world and going back to the Quran and seeing how this opens the Quran up to us. From a faith-based science to a faith-motivated science. There's many scientific phenomena which we have yet to use to explain the verses of the Quran instead of the other way around. What about the constancy of light, for example? Einstein showed that time is not constant. Rather, it's the speed of light that's constant. And his famous equation E=mc², that energy and mass can interchange as a function of speed of light squared. That's what that equation says. So the speed of light is the constant. And we've all heard the comparisons of light and nur to God, or those that possess signs of the divine. Our Masumin, for example, are referred to as proofs of God. Perhaps an ingenious Muslim physicist with knowledge of Quranic exegesis can find an explanation in scripture that light as a constant is a manifestation of God. Maybe that's something somebody should look into. And perhaps no one fits this description better than the teenage son of Imam Hussein. Hazrat Ali Akbar was born the likeness of Prophet Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He was so similar in physical features to Rasulullah that people would mistake him as such in the streets of Medina. To them, Ali Akbar was the face of Tawheed, a daily reminder of the message of his great-grandfather. Hussein and his companions had spent the night in prayers. Early morning, they came out of their tents and assembled to offer the morning prayers behind Imam Hussein. Rather than asking his muezzin, his trusted muezzin, who he had asked for years and years, Hajjaj ibn Masroor, to do the azan, Imam Hussein, on this day, the day of Ashura, asked his son Ali Akbar to recite the azan. The significance of this is that Hussein's son looked exactly like Prophet Muhammad in appearance, and that the azan has a sentence in its meaning. I testify to Muhammad being a God-sent prophet, which is said twice. Mir Anis, the famous Urdu poet, captured the scene in a few stanzas, in which he likens Ali Akbar to a nightingale singing in the garden of prophethood. Here is a beautiful translation of these lines by Professor David Matthews of the University of London. Then suddenly the dawn's white light came in to lead the prayer the king came from his throne. All stood behind the lord of men and jinn. Ali Akbar called the prayer in Hassan's tone. The eyes of everyone were filled with tears as if the prophet's voice fell on their ears. The birds fell silent, trees in ecstasy, rocked to and fro. Their buds and fruit sang praise. The towns and deserts joined in harmony, and ocean beasts emerged to hear their lays. The darling of Shabir to all lent weight. O'er land and sea they cried, our God is great! The women of the king wept bitter tears, while Banu of renown stood silently. Zainab repeated blessings with her prayers. My muezzin, I give thy life to thee. They call in praise of God, O hear their joy. As beautiful as Joseph is my boy. He reads from the Quran, what a majesty! His grandfather once for speaking held the prize. Ah, may his voice remain eternally. The strains of David, who was called the wise, those melodies like petals of a flower, a nightingale chirps in the prophet's bower. It was as if Imam Hussein was giving the people assembled to fight and to rethink their motives. For they claimed to be Muslims and were following the orders of a man claiming to be the rightful Khalifa of the Prophet of Islam, who openly flouted all Islamic covenants. And Imam Hussein was the grandson of the Prophet and was the most righteous person of his time, and he was being branded a rebel, Muslim. There were people in that crowd who had seen the Prophet and should therefore have been reminded of his looks by Ali Akbar standing up and reciting the azan. But it was clear that Umar Asad, the commander of Yazid's army and his troops, were not going to change their stance. After the prayers, Imam Hussein's followers took in turn to approach the troops and address them formally. This was important because every member in Imam Hussein's party had one or more relatives on the other side. And Imam Hussein himself rode towards the enemy troops and addressed them, explained the detail of who he was, his close relationship to the Prophet, his Puritan way of life, and that he was a peaceful citizen, living quietly without causing any disturbance to anybody. And that they were going to commit a grave sin by harming the Prophet's family. One after another, Imam Hussein's companions went to the battlefield in Karbala, and they were killed, bravely and courageously fighting. However, there was not a single soul from the house of Fatima that had been hurt to that point. Imam Hussein now asked his 18-year-old son, Ali Akbar, to proceed to fight. Ali, who looked like the Prophet Muhammad, came out of his tent attired in Prophet Muhammad's cloak and turban. The scene of Ali Akbar's departure from his tent has been described by eyewitness reports from among Yazid's army in the most touching terms and recorded in the books of history. When his son was proceeding towards the battlefield, Imam Hussein paused and, pointing his finger to the heaven, said, "Allah, be witness to the fact that now I am sending my son to be sacrificed, who looked exactly like your prophet in appearance, in speaking, in walking, and in character. When we wanted to see your prophet, we used to look at him." Ali, the son of Hussein, fought valiantly. He killed a number of enemy soldiers and rushed back to his father, who was watching his son fight with pride and admiration. Ali Akbar said to his father, "Oh father, is there any water to drink? You would really see me fight if I could just get one drink of water." Imam Hussein looked at his son hopelessly and cried and said, "Oh my son, proceed to paradise where your grandfather is waiting to greet you with drinks of eternal bliss." Ali Akbar returned to the battlefield with a new determination. Umar ibn Sa'd sent one of his senior commanders named Tariq ibn Shi'b to go and finish off Ali Akbar. Tariq was fully covered in armor. He came pointing his big lance and pushed his own lance through Tariq's chest. Tariq fell from his horse. Ali Akbar trampled him on the horse. Tariq's son came. He was watching this, and with a rage, he attacked Ali Akbar, but soon he too was killed. Then Tariq's second son, Talha, came and held Ali Akbar by the collar. Ali Akbar put his armor on Talha's neck and crushed it. Talha dropped from his horse. The enemy was stunned. Umar ibn Sa'd was perturbed. He sent another experienced commander to attack Ali Akbar, who was also killed very quickly. Umar now had no choice but to use the most cowardly tactic of all. He sent two of his senior officers with 1,000 swordsmen on one side and another 1,000 on the other side. So Ali Akbar had to fight on his left and his right. And he kept both groups at bay for a while. Finally, one of the commanders of Yazid's army, who was known to be an expert in throwing a lance, sneaked behind Ali Akbar, aimed his lance at Ali from a distance, and threw it with great force. This lance hit Ali Akbar in the back and pierced through his chest. Ali fell from his horse and called out to his father, "Baba." Imam Hussein rushed to his dying son's side. He saw his son in great pain, the broken blade of the lance stuck in his chest. He was bleeding profusely. Imam Hussein displayed a courage and strength unparalleled in human history. He pulled the blade out with his own hands and saw his 18-year-old son breathe his last breath. Imam Hussein called the remaining Hashemi young men and brought the dead body with their help and placed it. Ya Allah, please give us the courage to follow in the footsteps of Hazrat Ali Akbar, Imam Hussein, and all of our
brothers.
Ya Allah, please give us strength to understand the concept of Tawheed and spread it to those that we know and love. Ya Allah, please help us to remove oppression from this earth. Ya Allah, please give us the courage and strength to follow in the footsteps of the martyrs of Karbala and to become examples of the Ahlul Bayt.
Yahweh, 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 Yahweh,